So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another session of Thoracic Gurus. Actually, today we are fortunate to see the third Mahaguru of India. We are so fortunate to have with us Professor S.V. Sri Krishna, who is a senior consultant cardiothoracic surgeon in Bangalore at Narayan Hrudayalaya. And he's got a huge track record of teaching and training surgeons over the last many, many years. And a lot of people out there are highly indebted to him for having taken them through their careers, not just in thoracic, but he's also a very avid cardiac trainer as well. In his own clinical practice, he does all. He does cardiac, he does vascular, and nowadays he predominantly does thoracic. And he's also now got a young surgeon with him. So they are doing a lot of minimally invasive and also venturing into the robotic world. Thank you, Dr. Sri Krishna, for joining us today and your experience in the exams. You've been an examiner for, I don't even know how many years, sir. So please enlighten our students on you know, what are the tips and tricks of an examiner, or that an examiner is looking for in a student? How should they answer the sessions well? Take it away, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Zani, for those kind words of introduction. I must say I shamelessly enjoyed it. Today's lecture focuses on the basics of how one can make a decent presentation of a thoracic case in the exam. We all have been through a whole lot of master classes given by stalwarts and brimming with knowledge. However, this knowledge rarely translates to practice. First and foremost, examinations, though a bit unfair, are not insurmountable. And no examiner will come with an intent to fail. If you do happen to stumble, believe me, it will be mainly your own fault. Dr. Zamir has time and again stressed about the appearance in an examination, attitude, demeanor, and the confidence with which you face an examination. Impossible should become I am possible. I am aware that this mixed group of both pure thoracic surgical trainees as well as cardiothoracic surgical trainees in the last 20 years as an examiner, I have found that cardiothoracic residents struggle considerably in a thoracic case. As examiners, we do not want to know what you don't know. No one can answer all questions. All we want to know is whether you know the principles well, able to analyze the data, assess the condition of the patient in front of you, and come with a concrete plan for management. We want to know if you are a safe surgeon and send your patient home, as Dr. Zamir has said before. Don't quote from the books and literature unless asked for. This will not impress the examiner. We want to know what you will do in this case, and all questions, mind you, will be entirely practical, which an average surgeon faces with average resources available. Remember, what works in Philadelphia may not work in Tumkur or Dibrugarh. Also, as an examiner, we don't care if you have got the diagnosis wrong. In fact, if you tell me you have a case of pulmonary sequestration, I might be tempted to fail you. You need to deduce from history, physical findings, and come with a differential diagnosis. Then order relevant investigations to rule out different conditions and narrow down your diagnosis and propose a treatment plan. Again, there are many ways to skin a cat, though basically there are three ways. your way, my way, and the right. If you happen to quote your teacher or boss's method, which may not be a standard practice, be sure to know why he is doing that way and justify. It is logical. If it is logical, no examiner worth his salt will object. Lastly, please don't argue with your examiner. You may think that he is less knowledgeable, but he has a lot more experience and judgment.
Come down, man. Half ka half cash.
You know, good judgment comes from experience, and experience comes
Shri
from
Krishna, just, bad judgment. Sorry, just one second. Yeah. Shri Krishna, just one second. I'm sorry. Can we please request everybody to switch off your microphone? Who is Sayyid Rasool? Please switch off your microphone. I am not able to switch off your microphone. Please switch off your microphone, and please do not switch it on when the speaker is talking. Sayyid Rasool, if you don't switch off your microphone, I'll have to take you out of the meeting. So please switch off your microphone. Sorry, Shri Krishna. Sorry, just one second, Shri Krishna. Sorry about that. Sayyid Rasool, who's Sayyid Rasool? Hello. Yeah, please switch off your microphone. There's a background noise from your microphone which is disturbing the lecture. I don't know what settings you have, but I'm not able to control your microphone. So please switch it off. Thanks, Shri Krishna. I'm very sorry about this disturbance. I'm very sorry. Please continue.
Okay. With this brief introduction, now let us get down to business. Whenever you see a thoracic case, you are faced with a few basic conditions. You can have a consolidation, atelectasis or collapse, a mass lesion, which could be a solid or cystic, benign or malignant, or fluid in the pleural cavity. Here I would like to reiterate that I will be only dealing with basic principles and guidelines. Individual patient needs specific management and should be dealt with accordingly. After all, wisdom is superior to knowledge. Wisdom is a sum of knowledge and experience. Just because you have seen your boss do a complex sleeve resection by uniportal batch does not mean you should embark on such a procedure yourself. You all know the old saying, primum non nociere. If not, be sure you will end up with the ODTAA syndrome. One damn thing leads to another, after another. So, to begin with, This is the format which I have followed for many, many years. Any condition in medicine, be it an Epstein's anomaly or pulmonary sequestration or whatever, you need to answer these questions. What? What is the condition? That means the definition of the condition. Why does it occur? That means you must know the pathophysiology of the condition. Then, what happens when you don't do anything for this condition? So that means the natural history. And when do you need to intervene? That means you should know the indications. And when not, that means you should know the contraindications to do any procedure on the patient. Then you come to how. Oh, there are various techniques, various procedures, various things that you need to know, how it is done, and then lastly comes the outcome, that is the results and the long-term prognosis. If you follow this format, in whatever you do, not only for the exam, but also for your day-to-day practice, I'm sure you will do a good job. I have found many residents fumbling with basics. So I will go through a few slides to show what are these basics during the examination of a thoracic case. You all know the history part of it, and I'm not going to go into details. This may be almost like an MBBS level, but however, I need to stress on this. During the examination after inspection and palpation, you come to a thing called vocal tremitus. This is the sound or the vibrations that you feel on the chest wall. Normally, when you read or when you say 99, there are vibrations palpable on the chest wall. In a consolidation, the air passes through the lung and this goes onto the chest wall much closer, clearer. So the vibrations are increased. In pleural effusion and pneumothorax, the air passages pushed away from the chest wall and the vibrations are diminished. And in collapse, the passages are blocked, so the vibrations are decreased. So this will give you a clue what the underlying pathology is. Percussion, again, similar to what we talked about the tremitus, increased air in the lung, you have increased resonance, which occurs during emphysema or a pneumothorax. Air in the pleural cavity, increased resonance or tympanic as it is called. Less air in the lung is during consolidation or a collapse, and almost no stony dullness is classical of fluid collection in the chest cavity. You will be amazed how many people don't know the actual normal breath sounds. The tracheobronchial tree branches 23 times between the trachea and the alveoli. During a maximal breath in and out, the vital capacity, about 5 liters of air in a healthy adult, passes through each generation of the airway. In the larynx and trachea, this volume must pass through a cross-sectional area of only a few square centimeters, and therefore flow rate is fast, causing turbulence with vibration of the airway and wall and generating sounds giving rise to the bronchial breath. In the distal airway, the very large total cross-sectional area of the multitude of bronchioles means that 5 liters can easily pass at a slow flow rate, and so flow is normally virtually silent. Most of the sound heard when auscultating the chest wall originates in the large central airways, but is muffled and deadened by passage through overlying air-filled alveolar tissue. This, together with a small contribution from the medium-sized airways, results in normal breath sounds at the chest wall and sometimes the vesicle. There are few added sounds as well. Wheeze is a musical whistling sound accompanying airflow and usually originates in a narrow, small airway. Crackles accompanying deep breathing are thought to represent the sudden opening of small airway, but sometimes may indicate secretions in the airways or underlying fibrosis. Crackles that persist after several breaths and do not clear with a deliberate cough are pathological. They are graded as fine, meaning soft, multiple crackles, and coarse, indicating loud, scanty crackles that tend to change with each breath. The pleural rug is a rasping, grating sound occurring with each breath and sounding superficial just under the stethoscope. It indicates pleural inflammation and is often accompanied by pleuritic chest pain. This is a graphic representation of all the breath sounds. In the vesicular breath sounds, the expiration is much shorter than the inspiration, and there is no gap between each phase. In bronchial breathing, both inspiration and expiration are of the same caliber or same duration, and there is a definite gap. In bronchovesicular, there is no gap, but the expiration is much softer. In asthmatic, there is a prolonged airway expiration, and this is added with a wheezing noise. To summarize most of the things that we have talked about, consolidation, you have no shift of the mediastinum, there is increased tremitus, dull note and percussion, with sounds of bronchial, and sometimes you have late inspiratory crackles. Large pleural effusion, you have decreased or absent over the tremitus. Or stone eater, this is important. You know, the sometimes when you say stone eater, the examiner will know that you're talking about fluid in the chest cavity. It's just like saying low pitched rumbling mid-diastolic murmur means mitral stenosis and nothing else. So after the examination, you have to summarize your findings, suggest a diagnosis, a differential diagnosis, suggest initial investigations. With this, I mean, don't start off saying urine routine, blood routine, and things like that. You have to talk about relevant investigations, and the most of the relevant investigations are radiological imaging. Again, start with the simpler ones like the chest X-ray and ultrasound rather than go on to MR scan or PET scan straight away. Then, once you have done this, you have to answer three questions honestly. Does the patient require surgery? The second, is the patient fit for surgery? And lastly, is the patient's lifestyle likely to improve after surgery? If even one of these questions you have an answer no, you have no business in operating that patient. I hope you have to follow this all your life so that you practice good ethical practice. Now, when we say about assessment, we need to know the pulmonary function test. Dr. Zamir has given you an extensive talk on this, almost 2 hours, I think, about the various tests and how it is performed and how to interpret them. This is just to complete the talk. These things are mentioned here: airway function, lung volumes, diffusing capacity, blood gases, cardiopulmonary exercise test, and metabolic measures. This is important to know whether your patient is fit to undergo a surgical procedure. This table sort of summarizes all the things and saying about the lung capacity, what are the tests that are to be used for, airway resistance, gas exchange, muscle strength. This is very important, especially in the post-operative period. You have to assess muscle strength to have a good recovery period. Of course, cardiac evaluation and respiratory evaluation go hand in hand, and this is an absolute must, especially in the elderly patients. And effort and motivation for cooperation in the post-operative period. Don't forget the other systems. Nutritional status, most of our patients, especially the tuberculosis or esophageal cancers, have a very poor nutritional status. It also causes impaired immune function, impaired wound healing, and little can be done to correct this in a short term. However, you need to take precautions to try and optimize the nutritional status before embarking on a major surgery. Hepatic dysfunction and coagulopathy play a major role, and of course, renal dysfunction is also very important. Now we come to the basic conditions that we encounter. You can have a consolidation. You can have atelectasis, you can have a mass lesion, and you can have, if it is small, you can have a nodule, or if it is diffuse and in infiltrating in including the entire parenchyma will be an interstitial lung disease. So to reiterate, consolidation, we have no shift of the mediastinum, trachea is not deviated, vocal parameters is increased, dull note and percussion, bronchial or vesicular, bronchovesicular breath, sometimes late inspiratory rounds. Consolidation usually is due to accumulation of fluid in the parenchyma, could be due to infection, edema, fibrosis, tumor, or idiopathic. Something happening.
Just go on to the next slide, actually. Yeah, go on to the next slide. Yeah, that's better.
So in consolidation, we have three patterns. You have to time it, whether it's an acute consolidation or a chronic one. What is the content in the alveolus? Is it water, pus, blood, or cells? And the pattern, whether it is diffusely involving the entire lung, or is it only lobar? Is it multiple ill-defined, like in the staphylococcal pneumonia or septic emboli? Or you have edema pattern like the battering appearance or the reverse pattern. So all this has to be assessed by radiological teams. Now we come to another condition called atelectasis or collapse. Shift of the mediastinum is to the affected side, shift of the trachea to the affected side, vocal parameters is increased, dull note and percussion, and usually absent breath sounds. Atelectasis can be due to resorption, due to an occlusion of the bronchus, resorption of the distal airway, parenchyma, air in the parenchyma, because of a mucus plug, tumor or a foreign body occluding the bronchus. Or it could be passive because of a pleural effusion, pneumothorax, or a round atelectasis compressed. Radiological signs of atelectasis is displacement of the intralobar fissures and crowding of vessels and bronchi. There is local increase in opacity, elevation of the hemidiaphragm, displacement of the mediastinum, overinflation of the remaining lung, displacement of hilum, and crowding of the lung. Different patterns of atelectasis of the lobes of the lung, the right upper lobe, right middle lobe, lower lobe, and the left side, upper lobe and the lower lobe. This forms like an opacity in these regions on the chest X-ray, PA lateral. Now we come to a mask lesion. Now you have to differentiate a nodule from a mask. A nodule is an opacification which is less than 3 centimeters, usually a healed granuloma from a TB or metastasis from a lung cancer or a metastasis from elsewhere. A mask lesion is more than 3 centimeters, usually a lung cancer, granuloma, or a tumor. Sometimes you may have multiple masses, most commonly with the infection like TB or septic emboli, malignancy and metastasis from elsewhere or sarcoidosis. So when you see a mask lesion, what do you do? First, you see whether it is within the lung or outside the lung. If it is outside the lung, is it in the mediastinum? You have differentiation anterior, mid, and posterior mediastinum. Is it from the esophagus, chest wall, or pleura? If it is within the lung, is it benign or malignant? This will be confirmed by biopsy. If it is malignant, then you have to know whether it is primarily from the lung or a metastasis from elsewhere. So if it is primary from the lung, the three common cancers in the lung are adenocele, squamous cell CA, or a neuroendocrine cancer. These can be confirmed with the immunohistochemistry pattern. If it is adeno-CA, you have TTF1 positive, NAPCIN positive, CK7 positive. If it is squamous cell, you have CK56 positive, T40 and T63 positive. In neuroendocrine, you have chromogranin and synaptophysin. If you detect these immunohistochemistry markers, then you can more or less come to a conclusion what the mask lesion is. Now, pleura, you can have again primary or secondary tumors. Primary could be from a mesothelioma, a secondary could be from an adenocarcinoma from elsewhere. If it is mesothelium, these two are important because histopathologically also you cannot differentiate a mesothelioma from a metastatic adenocarcinoma. So you need immunohistochemistry to differentiate the two. And if it is CK56 and calreticulin or thrombomodulin positive, then it is most likely that it will be a mesothelioma. Of course, metastasis from elsewhere, you have the markers for the primary tumors, breast, kidney, GI tract, thyroid, adrenal, prostate, and bone. This is how you would go about assessing a mask lesion. Then we come to a nodule. The nodule, which is smaller than 3 centimeters, is called the solitary pulmonary nodule. And the most common of them would be a granuloma, a tuberculous granuloma in our setup. Bronchial carcinoma, metastasis may be also found. So you need to know again here whether it is benign or malignant. And the most important way of knowing is their duration. Or if you have serial X-rays or serial CT scans, you know their doubling time, what is their progression, and also the presence or absence of calcification will let you know whether it is a benign nodule or a malignant nodule, whether you need to wait and watch or you need to intervene as quickly as possible. Again, multiple masses are also present. Multiple masses are usually again, tuberculosis, septic emboli, and bronchoalveolar CA, and in the inflammatory lesion, sarcoid and pulmonary infarcts can have multiple mask lesions. Patterns are not really a surgical problem. They are classified as reticular, nodular, low attenuation and high attenuation. Most of the time, surgeons don't get involved in this except for probably doing a lung biopsy to confirm what pattern of interstitial disease there is. Or if there is extensive interstitial lung involvement, then surgical management of them would be a transplant of the lung. Next, we have these three varieties, a cavity, a cyst, and an emphysema. How do you differentiate that? Cavity has a wall more than 3 millimeter thick, maybe due to infection, neoplasm, and necrotizing neoplasm, or a vascular lesion. Cysts are thin-walled, less than 3 millimeters, usually congenital, bronchogenic cyst, adenomatoid malformation, or you can have a large bulla, pneumatocele, or a post-traumatic cyst. Multiple are usually emphysema. Sorry about that. You are having some problem with my computer.
Yeah, I think your screen is become green.
No, it's not responding. I need to get it back. Yeah, now it's okay. Now we come to the pleura. Pleura is, you have the visceral pleura and the parietal pleura with a space in between, and there is normally, there is an extrapleural plaque, endothoracic fascia, and all these things, and then there is normally some amount of fluid that is present in the pleura. I am not going into the details of the physiology, but when you see a pleural thickening, pleural collection, it could be fluid, it could be a tumor, metastasis or mesothelioma, as we talked about it before. It could be fluid, just plain paraneumonic effusion, or infective pathology like an empyema, or it could be a pneumothorax or even a thyrothorax. Benign pleural thickening rarely affects mediastinal pleura, whereas malignant mesothelioma most often involves the mediastinal pleura. Just to highlight this fact, this is just an empyema with underlying collapsed lung, and this is a nodular mesothelioma which is involving the mediastinal pleura as well. Then we have hilar mediastinal lymphadenopathy. It could be in our country, the most common would be TB. Then you can have sarcoid, or you can have lymphoma. These are the three commonest mediastinal lymphadenopathy that we encounter and which may be required to biopsy. And again, mediastinal lymphadenopathy could be unilateral or bilateral. And here are the three common things that I told you about: sarcoid, TB, and lymphoma. These are all surrogate markers. However, the final diagnosis depends on tissue diagnosis. And this can be achieved by various techniques, either by EBUS, mediastinoscopy, VATS, or even an open thoracotomy. Now let's go on to some specific conditions. Again, I'm reiterating you that I'm only talking to you about what is standard procedures or basic principles of most of the conditions that we encounter. Again, some cases have to be individualized and probably treated slightly. Talked about effusion. Effusion, there is shift of the mediastinum to the opposite side. Trachea is deviated to the opposite side. Vocal tremitus is decreased or absent. And it is dull to stony dull on percussion. This is the key word. And this has to be brought out when you're presenting the case and absent rhythm. So you need to know whether the effusion is a transudate or an exudate, and that I'm sure most of you know the LICE criteria. I'm not going to do the details about it. And pleural fluid analysis with various markers. If the pro-BNP is more than 1,500, consider heart failure. If the CRP is more than 45, consider infection. If the ADA is more than 35, you consider tuberculosis. If it is CA positive, then consider pleural mix. If there's suspicious inclusive cytology, immunostaining, EMA positive, calreticulin, then you may have to consider mesothelioma, or EMA positive, calreticulin is positive, mesothelioma. If it is TTF1 positive, it could be a metastatic lung cancer, or if there is only calreticulin, thrombomodulin, then you can consider mesothelioma. This is how you would probably analyze the pleural fluid and then sort of deduce what is the cause. This is a slightly complex slide, giving you all the pathophysiology, the clinical appearances, biochemistry, and the mouse microbiology of the main conditions: paraneumonic effusion, complicated paraneumonic effusion, and then ultimately coming down to empyema. So in this, the treatment part, you can see that the surgery for all these care conditions plays a minimal role. Most of the things are medical management.
Initially,
sorry?
Okay. Neeta, please switch off your microphone. Sorry, sir, sorry.
So when we come to empyema, most of you know these stages. If you don't know, then it is very sad. You have to know this before you go to the examination, because this empyema is one of the most common cases that are given to you. You have three stages: exudative stage, 1 to 3 days; fibrinopurulent stage, occurs between 4 to 14 days; and organizing stage after 14 days. So there is, this is an immediate response, outpouring of fluid into the pleural cavity. It has a low cellular content. It is simple paraneumonic effusion and with a normal pH and glucose levels. Later on, it reaches the fibrinopurulent stage. Large number of polymorph pro-nuclear lymphocytes accumulates. Fluid pH and glucose levels fall. LDH rises and neutrophils and fibrin and effusion becomes purulent. There's progressive tendency towards loculation, and the pleural fluid analysis with a pH less than 7, glucose less than 40, and LDH more than 1000 tells you that this is an infective process. Finally, you come to the stage of organizing stage, where fibroblasts grow into the exudates, and there is a development of an inelastic membrane called the peel. Thickened pleural peel may prevent the entry of antimicrobial drugs in the pleural space, and in some cases can lead to drug resistance. These are the various images. Okay, now this is a simple effusion. You can see the classical ellipsis curve, and most probably this is a thin fluid which could probably be drained with a large bore needle. And this is a case where there is, on ultrasound, you can see multiple septations, and just a single ICD may not help, and you may have to break down these loculi, and maybe a VATS procedure would be useful in this situation. This is a multi-loculated effusion or an empyema with loculations in various parts with septae in between. Thickened septae and thickened pleura between the fissures and both these things. And this is especially in the mediastinal area, which will not be accessible with an ICD and which definitely requires operative intervention. That is how you decide which patients can be treated conservatively and which patients do require surgical management. The goals in management of empyema are to evacuate the infected material and ensure the re-expansion of the lung parenchyma with no residual space. No space, no problem. The chain of intervention from least to most invasive then proceeds from small bore catheters to chest tubes, to VATS, evacuation and declotication, to thoracotomy for declotication, to open window thoracostomy. This is how the sequence goes on. And the surgical principles of declotication remain the same regardless of the approach, open or VATS. That means to say that you will excise both the visceral and the parietal pleura all round, including the mediastinum and the diaphragm and the chest wall, to allow good expansion of the lung and improve the respiratory mechanism. The infected material needs to be evacuated. The additions of the lung to the chest wall, mediastinum, diaphragm need to be taken down. And the underlying parenchyma needs to have thickened pleural ring removed, enabling expansion of the lung, allowing it to fill the hemithorax and obliterate any residual space. Thickened parietal pleura over the lateral chest wall and the diaphragm need to be removed to restore chest wall. Now this is sort of an algorithm, how you go about, depending on the stage of the empyema, I mean pleural effusion. So initially, the patients usually present with dyspnea, chest pain, fever, cough, and the labs and x-ray will tell you what the collection is. This can first be initially treated by a thoracosynthesis or acute thoracostomy. If the whole thing is drained and resolved, there is no further treatment. If it reaccumulates, maybe recurrent, then you will have to go in for a VATS for a bedside fluorodesis. If it is loculated and infected, evaluate for decortication. And if it is sterile, second drainage procedure, and still if does not settle down, go back and evaluate for decortication. Here, depending on the stage of the disease, early diagnosis, VATS decortication, late diagnosis, more than 14 days, open decortication or a thoracotomy. Nowadays, I'm sure most of the people are still able to do VATS decortication even in advanced organized empyemas. And in high-risk patients, a rib resection or an alopecia window is resolved. As surgeons, we are faced with a few problems in the postoperative period. These are distressing problems, a post-lobectomy empyema. So if there is no space, ICD or alopecia procedure with BPF, closure of fistula, without BPF, ICD or alopecia procedure. But if there is a space with BPF, you put in an ICD first, medically stable, myoplasty with a muscle flap closure. Medically unstable, you can resort to an alopecia procedure. And a space without BPF, start with an ICD, medically stable, muscle flap closure. Or sometimes, if you have the ICD, can becomes unstable, then you have to resort to an alopecia. A similar situation can occur in a post-pneumonectomy empyema space without BPF or with BPF. You can also have this in an acute phase. You drain the chest tube drainage and then most of them might settle down without BPF. But in a chronic stage, attempt a modified colitis success, or if it fails, you do a complete plan. If there is a BPF, chest tube drainage, fistula closed, possible modified colitis success. If it fails, go to a complete flap. Or if the fistula is open, you can go on to a complete flap or a alopecia window. Now comes to a case where there is air, increased air in the lung or increased air in the pleural cavity. There is shift of the mediastinum to the opposite side. Trachea is deviated to the opposite side. Vocal tremitus is absent. Hyperresonant or tympanic note on percussion, breath sounds are absent. Breath sounds will be present in emphysema, but will be probably totally absent in a pneumothorax. This is a picture of a pneumothorax, which shows that the lung is collapsed towards the hilum, and there is a lung margin that is visible. The collapsed lung, you can see a lung margin. Here, this is a stable pneumothorax. There is no shift of the mediastinum. The diaphragm is almost normal. As against this picture, where there is a collapsed complete pneumothorax, and there is shift of the mediastinum, there is the diaphragm is way down and there is increased spaces between the rib cage. So this is a tension pneumothorax and becomes a medical emergency and immediate life-threatening situation. This is something which most of the residents have a problem. They should know, because this is very, very important to differentiate a pneumothorax from a bulldog. In the pneumothorax, as I said before, the lung is down and close to the hilum. It is collapsed towards the hilum, but you can see a nice plump border. As against a bulla, where there is hyperlucency, but there is no lung border seen from the chest wall. So if you put in a, this requires an ICD, but if you put in a chest tube here, you might make the patient worse, because there will be continuous airway. So this is extremely important to differentiate between a pneumothorax and a bulla. Sometimes a giant bulla will not show anything here. You may think that it is a pneumothorax with absolutely no lung tissue at all, and put in a tube and make the patient worse. So what are the treatment options? You can have, if it is very minimal, less than one intercostal space, you can do an observation, or you can have just a needle aspiration. Many a time we put in a chest tube, and subsequently, once the lung is expanded, you can do a pleurodesis. Most of the time, we end up doing either thoracoscopy or thoracotomy with a wedge resection, pleurodesis, mechanical or chemical with pleurectomy. This is the algorithm from the British Thoracic Society. This is available in almost all the textbooks, so you can access this from any other. Now, what is the indication for surgery in a patient with pneumothorax? First episode with prolonged air leak more than 3 days. Second or third recurrence on the same side. First occurrence on the contralateral side. Associated with pneumothorax more than a liter. Associated with pleural sepsis. Incomplete re-expansion. Occupational risk. Pilots, divers, mountain guides, etc. Synchronous bilateral pneumothoraces, life-threatening episode, or a patient living in remote areas. These are patients who require surgery on the first instance. Now we move to another condition, the bronchitis cases. This is again a very important case that is usually given to you in the exam. Bronchic cases are of four varieties: cylindrical, sacular, varicose, or traction bronchitis. So what are the causes? Most common cause in our country will still be tuberculosis. We don't see cystic fibrosis so often. There will be a bronchial obstruction with distal sequia, destruction of the lung, usually following a foreign body aspiration, and of course the various other immunological deficiency stages. You can also have connective tissue disorders, alpha antitrypsin deficiency, autosomal polycystic disease, and toxic gas exposure as other causes, rarer causes of bronchitis. Again, remember, don't start off talking about all these things. Common things to be talked about first. Rare causes are rarely right. And so tuberculosis is one of the first cases, important things that you will talk about in case of bronchitis. How does it occur? There is partial obstruction. It can end up with an emphysema of the lobe. If the partial obstruction becomes complete obstruction, air gets absorbed, the lobe collapses, secretions are retained, giving rise to infection, and spread of infection are all over the lobe or the rest of the lobe on the same side, sometimes maybe the opposite side. Destruction of bronchial wall, negative pleural pressure pulls the wall of the bronchi, dilatation of the bronchi, cilia are destroyed, and the secretions accumulate in the sacs of the bronchial, distended bronchial. Inflammation causes obliteration of the pulmonary vessels, resulting in large bronchial vessels. The therapy for bronchic cases involves treatment of the underlying disorder, if possible, suppression of the bacterial load through appropriate antibiotics, encouragement of proper pulmonary hygiene, including the routine use of bronchodilators, mucolytic agents, and postural drainage, and surgery in select cases. The role of surgery is in patients with focal areas of disease with localized lung parenchymal destruction, a candidate for resection therapy, usually via a segmentectomy or a lobectomy. The rare patient who presents with massive hemoptysis should be considered for surgical therapy as early as possible. This I have put in italics because this is not a common cause. Some patients with bilateral end-stage bronchic cases may be candidates for lung transplantation. We come to lung abscess. Here, we need to differentiate a loculated emphysema versus a lung abscess. In these two chest x-rays, you can see that this is a pleural based collection because the angle between the chest wall and the collection is obtuse. So this is collected from outside the lung and pushing the lung inside. So this is a pleural based collection, whereas in this is an abscess cavity within the parenchyma of the lung, and it forms distance an acute angle with the chest wall. You can see that this chest wall is an acute angle. Here again, it's an acute angle. There is air fluid level, and this is lung abscess, whereas this is a loculated emphysema. The causes could be aspiration, most common cause, and the right lower lobe is most frequently affected. Actually, the commonest lobes that are involved is the superior segment of the lower lobe and the posterior segment of the upper lobe. This is also known as the axillary lobe, this combination, because in a supine patient, the openings of these two segments are upwards and secretions or as whatever is aspirated, especially in a chronic alcoholic, it can go into these segments and cause an abscess. Post-pneumonic infection, very common with the staph aureus or a Klebsiella pneumonia. It degenerates, the consolidation degenerates and forms an abscess. Post-obstructive, as we talked about, the foreign bodies or a mucus plug or a tumor, septic emboli, and miscellaneous causes. There are some important or special types of lung abscesses. The staphylococcal lung abscess can be multiple or bilateral. The staph lung abscess causes tension in the abscess, leads to a rupture of the abscess cavity, ending up with a pneumothorax, pyopneumothorax, and if the bronchus is permanently narrowed, it forms a pneumatocele. This is a very common presentation, especially in children with staphylococcal lung abscess. The other important one is the anemic lung abscess, because presents with hemoptysis, anchovisous sputum, and amoebae in the sputum, and secondary infection is very common in these patients and becomes chronic. Usually basal segments and the middle lobe are involved. Fungal abscesses like actinomycosis will also have numerous sinuses. So when do we do surgery for these? Indication for surgical intervention would include emphysema, development of a bronchopleural fistula, significant hemoptysis, persistence of the abscess despite adequate therapy, and suspicion of an underlying malignancy. So this algorithm again shows you the initial investigation, and you can have a single abscess or a multiple abscess on the CT scan. And if it is typical with non-immunocompromised cases, therapy, antibiotics, and they usually resolve. If there is atypical and bronchoscopy or FNA shows that there is a foreign body removal will usually settle that. If it is a tumor, needs a tumor resection. If it is an unusual organism, you have to do a specific therapy for this, like I told you, the actinomycosis abscess or an amoebic abscess, they need a specific therapy. And if there is failure or a complication, then you need to go in for a resection. If there are multiple, again, non-immunocompromised diagnosis, specific therapy usually resolves. If there is no, the immunocompromised patients usually end up with specific therapy, may end up with a resection. Now we come to the next commonest cause in our country, the tuberculosis. Dr. Deewan had an extensive lecture a couple of days ago, and I'm sure all of you are still fresh in your mind. However, let's see what happens to the natural history. What happens to the primary complex that affects the body? Once the tuberculous bacillus is inhaled, it forms a parenchymal lesion and a local regional lymph node enlargement, which is known as the primary complex or the gone form. What happens to that? It can heal with or without calcification if the immune status of the individual is good. It could get walled off by a collagen tissue, and it can lie dormant for a long period, number of years, and can get reactivated later on, and it is called the post-primary tuberculosis. It can be actively aggressive or progressive, and aggressive thing, and then progress on to progressive pulmonary tuberculosis in the first instance itself. Or the tuberculous bacillus can enter the bloodstream. This can form, in the acute form, can go disseminate all over the body, causing biliary tuberculosis or UV meningitis. Or in the chronic form, it can get lodged into various organs like the lung, pleura, bones, joints, kidney, brain, and the pericardium. So what happens to sequelae of tuberculosis? You can have parenchymal lesions, tuberculoma, inward cavity, cicatrization, end-stage lung destruction, aspergilloma, or a bronchogenic carcinoma. Airway lesions are bronchiectasis, tracheobronchial stenosis, or bronchodilation. Vascular lesions form are pulmonary or bronchial arteries, arthritis, and thrombosis, bronchial artery dilatation, and Rasmussen's aneurysm. Mediastinal lesions can have lymph node calcification, esophago bronchial fistula or diverticula, constrictive pericarditis, and fibrosing mediastinum. Pleural lesions could end up with a pneumothorax, pleurisy with effusion, chronic empyema, fibrothorax, or a bronchopleural fistula. In the chest wall, it could form cold abscesses, tuberculous osteomyelitis, tuberculous spondylitis, hot spine, or even end up with malignancy. What are the indications for surgery in tuberculosis? This has also been extensively discussed before. I'm only highlighting only a few of the principles, basic principles. If you have a persistent sputum positive cavity, TB bronchial stenosis, post-TB bronchiectasis, massive hemoptysis, TB empyema, TB bronchopleural fistula, or a scar cancer. The complication for surgery for TB includes post-pneumonectomy space empyema, a dreaded complication for any thoracic surgeon, bronchopleural fistula, residual space problem, pneumonia, wound breakdown, bleeding, and respiratory. One of the commonest sequelae of tuberculous cavities or cavities is fungal infection, opportunistic fungal infection like the aspergillosis. The other common fungus that are involved are the actinomycosis, mucormycosis, or the candida. we don't see the rarer organisms very often in our body. So indication for thoracic surgical intervention in a fungal disease would be to establish a diagnosis, failure of medical therapy of fungal disease versus lung carcinoma in a necrotizing cavity, malignant cavity, fungal superinfection, especially candida, can grow. The case of an aspergilloma usually present in long-standing tuberculosis cavities, more common in patients with diabetes and immunosuppressed patients, frequently associated with dense vascular adhesion. Medical therapy usually not effective because amphotericin penetrates aspergillus cavities poorly. Prophylactic resection in asymptomatic patients is generally not indicated because of significant complication rate. But these aspergillomas are notoriously prone for prolonged space problem after lobectomy. You can see that this patient, so this is the immediate post-op in February. Then the space persisted, and then he was converted into an apical tube, and then discharged with an apical tube, came back in March, the space is still present, and then April, the lung is almost complete, coming up to the apex, expanding. And finally, in May, the lung was fully expanded, and then we were able to pull out this. So they are notoriously prone for prolonged space problems. Actinomycosis is important to note that actinomycosis does not occur in isolation from other bacteria. This infection depends on other bacteria, gram-positive, gram-negative, and cocci, to aid in the invasion of tissue. Thoracic infection occurs after aspiration of an oropharyngeal organism, presents as empyema, infiltrate, consolidation, or even a hilar mass. This is an example showing a large infection with actinomycosis, and this is cavitating and then causing something like an abscess cavity. Pulmonary mucormycosis manifests non-specifically as fever, dyspnea, and cough. Hemoptysis may occur in presence of necrosis. Most patients with pulmonary disease have malignancies and a history of neutropenia. The fungus tends to invade arteries. As a result, blood clots form and tissue dies. The fungus grows uncontrolled in the dead tissue, which turns black, and the surrounding areas may bleed. Usually, mucormycosis affects the sinuses and then trickles down into the lung parenchyma. Immunocompromising conditions are the main risk factors. Patients with uncontrolled diabetes and cancer, or especially those who are neutropenic, have received broad-spectrum antibiotics are at risk. Patients receiving immunosuppressive agents, including oral or intravenous steroids, are at risk. It is a very serious infection. Even when as much infected and dead tissue as possible is removed and antifungal drugs are used appropriately, many people will with this infection die. Mucormycosis carries a very high mortality rate of 50 to 85%. It's a dreaded infection. This is the next most very common condition that we see in our country. This is a single cyst of Echinococcus granulosus. It is single cyst. It can be usually this is removed with a Barrett's procedure. And if there are multiple cysts like this, it's usually due to Echinococcus multilocalis. So, what is the aim of surgical treatment? Is to eradicate the parasite, remove the endocyst without intraoperative seeding, close the pericystic cavity created after the excision of cyst, and maximize the preservation of healthy lung tissue. These are the principles. The steps, the selection of the order of operations based on whether the cysts are bilateral or located in other organs like the liver. Selection of incision types, including thoracotomy, Beaton's sternotomy, thoracoabdominal incision, video-assisted thoracoscopy, depends on the site of the or location of the cyst. The timing of the surgery is in relation to the use of medication. If somebody, because if you use albendazole preoperatively, it causes necrosis of the cyst wall and they tend to rupture very quickly. So if you do have to start albendazole, you must go in and operate them within 4 to 5 days. The selection of intraoperative approach for the excision of the cyst and selection of the technique for closure of the pericystic cavity or selection not to make any closure. Surgical options that are available are enucleation, pericystectomy, cystostomy with catheter notch, cystostomy with closure of bronchial openings and catheter notch, cystostomy with closure of bronchial openings only, segmental resection, and lobectomy operations may be considered. Here, this is an italics among them. Parenchymal resections should be reserved as a last resort. This is a Barrett's procedure. The pericyst is incised and gradually the cyst is separated from the underlying pericystic cavity. And as the anesthetist blows, the bronchial opening breathes air into the cavity and it pushes the cyst wall just completely intact. This is as we used to call the only operation the anesthetist does. Indications for lobectomy are as follows. In a large cyst involving more than 50% of the lung, a cyst with severe suppurative pulmonary infection not responding to medical treatment, or multiple unilobar cysts in a lobe. Sequelae of hydatid cysts such as fibrosis, bronchiectasis, severe hemorrhage, and destroyed lung or the other conditions where a lobectomy may be involved in a patient with hydatid. Resection rate is usually higher, was higher in the pediatric population, ranging from 1.5 to 16%. The indication for parenchymal resections were giant cysts occupying the entire lobe, multiple cysts, and an unexpandable lobe after excision of the cyst. The remaining lung is often functional when bronchial secretions are suctioned and the lung is inflated with high inspiratory pressure. For this reason, even if a cyst occupies more than 50% of the lobe, the quality of the parenchyma should be evaluated before proceeding to the resection, with only one important exception, massive hemoptysis. Now we come to emphysema of the lung. Emphysema is classified as paraseptal, centrilobular, or panacinc. In the paraseptal area, we have three varieties called the bleb, the bulla, or the giant bleb. A bleb is coalesced alveoli less than 1 centimeter. Bulla is coalesced alveoli more than 1 centimeter. And a giant bulla is something that occupies more than 30% of the chest cavity. Centrilobular can cause a heterogeneous emphysema involving only the upper lobe or homogeneous involving the entire lung. And panacina is homogeneous, usually occupying the entire lung. These are varieties of this is a bleb where the coalesced alveoli are less than 1 centimeter. This is a bulla, usually in the apex, coalesced alveoli more than 1 centimeter. And this is a giant bulla occupying 30% of the chest cavity. The surgical option is a bullectomy, is a surgical removal of a bulla, which is causing increase in the physiological dead space or causing pneumothorax. It involves three stages. first you do a bullectomy, stapled, ligated or sewn by open or wax, apical pleuroectomy or a pleural stent, and pleural disease by abrasion or valve. All these three are involved in treating a bullet. The most common indication for a bullectomy include severe dyspnea due to a giant bulla, spontaneous secondary pneumothorax, pain, repeated infection, or pneumophthisis. Contraindications for a bullectomy would include significant comorbid disease, poorly defined bullae on the chest imaging, or pulmonary hypertension. So this is the distribution. Pyoceptal usually is seen in aged patients. Centrilobular is usually seen in patients with COPD with a long history of smoking. And panlobular is usually seen in alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. This is an example of a heterogeneous emphysema. You can see that only the upper lobes are involved. The lower lobes are more or less normal. The objectives of concern for the surgeon are following. How much of lung adjacent to the bulla to remove, the method of resection, and prevention of air leak. These are the three most important concerns for the surgeon. There are a lot of controversies and what approach that you're going to use. Median sternotomy or VATS, VATS LVRS, one lung or two lungs simultaneously or sequentially, or VATS simultaneous or staged. I am not going to the details. This is a sort of a homework for you to find out what the controversies are and how you would like to manage if you are given a case of emphysema. The next question is how much of lung to remove and where from. The resection generally removes about 60% of the volume of the right upper lobe or the upper division of the left upper lobe. Rarely, the entire upper lobe is resected. If the CT and perfusion scans show that the anterior segment of the upper lobe is not destroyed by emphysema, then it is preserved. In that case, the staple line begins in the mid-axillary line and proceeds from lateral to medial over the top of the lung. From here, you can go right up onto the top. So almost 30 to 35% of the lung on each side is removed during LVRS. This is again, when we talk about LVRS, we have to know the lessons from the NET in National Emphysema Trial. And this is again a homework for you people to know what exact recommendations are from the NET. So we have two options for extensive emphysema, LVRS and lung transplant. How do we decide what to do? Indications common to both procedures is emphysema with destruction of and hyperinflation of both the lungs, marked impairment, FEV1 less than 35% predicted, marked restriction in activities of daily living, and failure of maximal medical treatment to correct symptoms. These are for both. Contraindications for both, abnormal body weight, less than 70% or more than 130% of ideal, coexisting major medical problems, increasing surgical risk, inability or unwillingness to participate in pulmonary rehabilitation, this is very important, unwillingness to accept the risk of morbidity and mortality of the surgery, tobacco use within the last 6 months, recent or current diagnosis of malignancy, increasing age, and psychological instability such as depression or anxiety. These are contraindications for both the procedures. So discriminating conditions favoring LVRS would be marked thoracic distension, heterogeneous disease, This is important. Heterodivision lenses only are useful for LVRs, FEV1 more than 20% predicted, and age 60 to 70 or even above, depending on the condition. Conditions favoring lung transplant would be diffuse disease without target area. That means in a homogeneous emphysema, FEV1 less than 20%. Hypercarbia, PaCO2 of 7.3, that is 55 millimeters of mercury. And most important is presence of pulmonary hypertension and age less than 60, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. These are candidates for lung transplant. Pulmonary hypertension plays an important role in deciding whether a patient needs a transplant or he is contraindicated to go for LVR. Now we come to lung cancer. These are cartoon images of the various types of lung cancers. Adenocarcinoma. It's usually aggressive metastatic behavior. Contralateral met without N1 involvement is also possible. Here, the N1 is not there. You have N2 nodes and a contralateral. Small cell, contiguous mediastinal adenopathy, mass with a small node, clear parenchymal primary. With extensive mediastinal nodes here in a small cell tumor. Squamous cell, propensity to necrose, orderly metastatic behavior, N1 and then N2. Usually it starts with N1 and then go on to N2, unlike here. Here there's a skip lesion. Squamous cell can arise in the main bronchus, often associated with hemoptysis and airway obstruction, and may be very subtle on imaging. You may not even be able to see this, but it may cause distal obstruction, distal atelectasis. And squamous cell synchronous usually happens in the contralateral lung. So these are various presentations that can happen in lung cancer. So adenocarcinoma, this is important. Almost all of you will have to know the latest IASLC and ATS-ERS classification of lung adenocarcinoma. It's the 8th edition. And the adenocarcinoma, the whole thing has been changed into atypical hyperplasia, adenocarcinoma in situ, minimally invasive adenocarcinoma, and then aggressive tumors. Here again, there are various stages, lipidic predominant, acinar predominant, papillary predominant, micropapillary predominant, solid, and invasive. The reason for this differentiation is to predict the prognosis of the cancer in the patient. Here they are the immunomarkers, cytokeratin and TTF1 are positive in adenocarcinoma. Cytokeratin C56 is negative. Squamous cell morphology, the classical thing is the detection or demonstration of a keratin pearl that is seen in the cancer. Immunohistochemistry pattern, P63 and cytokeratin 56 are positive, TTF1 and CK7 are negative. And neuroendocrine, it could be atypical carcinoid, atypical carcinoid, small cell carcinoma, or a large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma. And here you have chromogranin, cyanotrophysin, and neuron-specific enolase. These are the immunomarkers that are classic for the neuroendocrine tumor. So when you have a patient with non-small cell cancer, morphology favors adenocarcinoma, then look for TTF1 positivity, NAPSIN positive, and CK56 negative, then you confirm adenocarcinoma. Morphology favors squamous cell carcinoma, TTF1 negative, NAPSIN negative, CK56 positive, and here P63 is also positive, then confirm squamous cell carcinoma. morphology of poorly differentiated cancer, you do all the tests, and then if TGF-1 positive, NAPCIN positive, it is more favoring adenocarcinoma. TGF-1 negative and T63 and CK56 positive, it favors squamous cell carcinoma. And then you work up for metastasis. This is how you go about the cancer. This is a classical slide. Everybody knows the stage grouping of lung cancer, the T, N, and M classification. The N1 nodes are the double digit nodes, the double digit stations. N2 nodes are the single digit stations in the mediastinum, and N3 are the contralateral nodes. So this is very important for staging the disease and then coming up with a treatment plan. So why stage a cancer? Staging determines treatment. Staging determines prognosis. Staging allows assessment of efficacy of treatment for each stage of the disease. Staging allows comparison of treatment for different stages of the disease between different centers. MRI and CT, these are usually the common
mode.
Sorry? Somebody said something? Okay. These are the two common imaging modalities that are used. So what are the differences between MRI and CT? In MRI, there is no ionizing radiation. It has better soft tissue contrast, better demonstration of neurovascular, esophageal, and chest wall involvement. And the definitive differentiation of cystic from solid lesions, hyperattenuating hemorrhagic and proteinaceous cystic lesions can be misperceived as solid on CT. More thorough and sensitive depiction of lesion complexity, detection of microscopic fat, blood products, fibrous tissue, cartilage, and smooth muscle, differentiation of muscles from nerves, tendons, and ligaments. Very, very, very important notation with ankylosteroid, which can involve the brachial plexus and the muscles in the apex of the chest. The next modality is PET. When do you use PET? In clinical stage 1, it helps to characterize the nodule as benign or malignant, although a negative result may still require histological confirmation unless the pretest possibility for malignancy is low. Helps to rule out occult metastasis to the mediastinum or extrathoracic sites. Helps to determine prognosis based on SUV intensity of the primary lesion. In stage 1B to 2B, helps to downstage or upstage the patient so that a more accurate staging can be done. Helps to assess early response to adjuvant therapy. And also, without further waste of time, expense, and unnecessary toxicity. Stage 3A helps to downstage or upstage the patient so that more accurate staging can be done. Helps to assess response to induction therapy if he is a surgical candidate. Helps to assess response to definitive chemo or radiotherapy. And helps to tailor radiation therapy to provide maximum effect. Clinical stage four, potentially downstage the patient if contradictory data are found between CT and PET and a biopsy confirms benign pathological condition at the M1 site. So these are the usefulness of doing a PET scan in the different stages of lung cancer. In this example, there is a node in the mediastinum, the subcarinal node, which is not very clear on the plain CT, but however, it is FPG avid and shows that this is an N2 lesion. So that is how a PET can actually grade or stage the disease better. In this patient, there is a central tumor occluding the bronchus and the distal portion of the lung is atelectated as a secondary event. So this whole thing, if on the CT, you might expect that this whole thing is a tumor, but the tumor is only there, and sometimes if it is a little smaller, you might even be get away with a clean resection and try to preserve, because this is all atelectatic lung. This is usually, this sleeve resection is usually resorted to in a patient with carcinoid. Here, this is not very clear whether the involvement of the pericardium is there or not, but a PET scan will be able to differentiate that and show the tissue involvement and the myocardial involvement in the surgical principles. Whenever possible, tumor and all associated lymphatic drainage must be removed completely, most frequently by lobectomy or pneumonectomy, rarely by pneumonectomy. Care must be taken not to transgress the tumor during resection to avoid tumor spillage. On-block resection of closely adjacent and immediate structure is preferable to discontinuous resection. Resection margin should be preferably be assessed by frozen section. Re-excision is preferred whenever possible. And all accessible mediastinal lymph node stations should be sampled or removed for pathological evaluation. So basic principle is that if there is a resectable lesion and there is an N1 disease, surgery is the treatment of choice. If there is a resectable lesion but there is an N3 disease, there is no role of surgery. N2 disease, the treatment is controversial. Single station N2 disease, resectable lesion, surgery could be offered in these patients because you might be able to afford or give a cure. Multiple N2 station disease, resectable, even if there is a resectable lesion, no surgery. Preferred for CT and or RT. Generally, M1 lesions are not suitable for surgery. However, if there are solitary metastases, then surgery may be offered. Patients occasionally present with resectable lung cancer and evidence of a solitary metastasis on a complete organ scanning. These patients should be considered for resection of both the primary tumor and the solitary metastasis. Brain mets. Untreated patients with brain metastasis have median survival of less than 3 months. When brain metastases are multiple or advanced, systemic disease is also present, the therapy of choice is whole brain irradiation. 1/3 of the patients presenting with brain metastasis have solitary lesions. Surgery offers the best form of palliation. When the brain lesion is detected first and the search for primary tumor is negative, resection of the brain metastasis is the therapy of choice. When the brain metastasis presents subsequent to the resection of primary, again, resection of the brain mets is indicated. When both brain and lung lesions are detected simultaneously, craniotomy is done first and thoracotomy shortly thereafter. Post-operative whole brain irradiation is required in all patients. If there is a solitary met in the adrenal, resection of the primary tumor and the solitary metastatic focus should be considered if both are completely resectable. It is rare for a true solitary metastasis from a lung primary to occur in the bone, liver, and other common metastatic sites. If both lesions, primary and solitary metastatic focus, are completely resectable, surgery therapy can be offered if the risks are low. The recent advances, there are lots of markers, ERB, KRAS, and various other markers that are available to detect in adenocarcinoma to give targeted therapy. So based on that, if the EGFR mutant is TKI represent responsive or TKI resistant, then the appropriate TKI drug can be used, or if it is not, then it may not be useful. So this is how you can actually personalize the therapy for lung cancer. This is slightly complicated, and nobody would penalize you in an exam if you don't know all the various markers and all the various drugs. There is a lot of overlap between a small cell, squamous cell, and the adenocarcinoma. It's almost impossible to remember all the things. This is the diagnostic thing. Once you have done a resection of the specimen, the resected specimen is gone through all these markers and the mutant this thing with EGFR ALK-based markers. And once you have got that, then you can actually give the appropriate drugs for them for the better prognosis of these patients. This is what is followed after resection of the lung cancer. So this is how the various targeted therapy things are: tyrosine kinase inhibitors, then gene therapy, then angiogenesis inhibitors, anti-EGFR, anti-HER2, and a whole lot of things. Interestingly, this is from one of the cancer textbooks, and this is a meta-analysis of VATS versus open thoracotomy for lung cancer. The operative mortality among the meta-analysis of almost 15 studies, there are more or less matched. Similarly, with the perioperative complications, hospital stay, and 5-year survival, there are more or less matched. So the trend nowadays is to go in for minimal invasive techniques, both VATS and robotics, if the tumor is in stage 1 or 2A. Of course, if the stage, there are people who are still doing stage 4 or chest wall resections, like Dr. Dartwell from France and various other places. So even advanced cancers are being subjected to surgery, and those are done only in specialized centers, and it is not for an everyday average surgeon like us. So coming to metastatic tumors, the primaries most commonly metastatic to lung are the thyroid, breast, colon, kidney, uterus, prostate, and oropharyngeal. Among the commonest tumors are choriocarcinomas, osteosarcomas, testicular tumors, melanoma, Ewing sarcoma, and Kaposi. So how do you select a patient for metastatectomy? A local control of the primary tumor or ability to completely resect the primary with synchronous presentations. Radiological findings consistent with metastatic disease. Absence of extrathoracic metastasis. Ability to perform a complete resection of the metastasis. No significant comorbidity that would preclude surgery. And no alternative therapy that is superior to surgery. Like, for example, a patient with an osteosarcoma with multiple mets in the lung, the surgery is the treatment of choice, whereas chemo radio will not be used. Now we come to the other portions of the chest cavity, disorders of the mediastinum. You all know that the mediastinum is divided into the anterior, mid, and posterior. And the commonest conditions that are occurred that occur in the anterior mediastinum are the thymoma, the thymicus, teratoma, thyroid, which is retrosternal goiters and blasen, and tuberculous nodes, or also sarcoid and lymphoma. So lymph nodes occur in all three zones. So you will be safe to say lymph nodes in all three.
Sir, we've lost your sound.
Sorry? You okay now? Hello?
Yes, voice is okay, sir.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Middle mediastinum tumors are the three A's: adenopathy, as we said before, aneurysms of the aorta or the pulmonary artery, or abnormalities of development, that is the four-gut cyst, that is the bronchial cyst, esophageal cyst, or a pleuropericardial cyst. Posterior mediastinal tumors are usually neurogenic and nerve root tumors. Occasionally, you have the esophageal tumors, descending thoracic aneurysms, bocalic hernias, and spinal tumors or abscesses. So these are the various things that are seen. If you see a germ cell tumor, you have to do the appropriate tumor markers like beta-HCG and the alpha-fetoproteins, thymic cysts and thyroid cysts need a biopsy, and of course the lymph nodes need a biopsy. Neurogenic cysts usually in the posterior mediastinum. Occasionally you will have to do an MRI to rule out intraspinal extension before you embark on surgical management for a neurogenic cyst in the posterior mediastinum. So this is again an algorithm which shows that the mediastinal mass, radiography and history tells you that there's a mediastinal mass. Labs are done, alpha-fetoprotein, HCG, VMA, and catecholamine markers are used to rule out the endocrine tumors. Radiography, chest CT, MRI, echo, PET, and iodine scans are done, and pathology is used, mediated metastanoscopy or laparoscopy. Once you have got, then you have a differential diagnosis, neurogenic cyst, 20%. Excision is the treatment of choice, and external beam radiotherapy can be offered. Thymic cyst, again, excision, chemotherapy, and external beam radiotherapy. Cyst, congenital, complete excision. Pericardial cyst, excision is symptomatic. Lymphomas, chemotherapy, and EBRT. Germ cell tumors, seminomas, or EBRT mainly, or non-seminoma germ cells, is chemotherapy and in this situation, unless they are causing some sort of a pressure symptom on the surrounding structure within the chest, most of them do respond to chemo and radiotherapy. But sometimes, many a time, they come very late with a huge tumor infiltrating or invading the surrounding structures of the trachea, the great vessels, pericardium. In such a situation, excision, surgical excision may be. Thymoma and myasthenia gravis, these are all the various conditions which can give rise to myasthenia gravis in thymic lesions. And the pathophysiology is seen that there is a problem in the neuromuscular junction with calcium channels, activates the calcium channels, the calcium increases the synaptic vessels containing acetylcholine to be released into the synaptic cleft. And then that causes the T cell process produces acetylcholine receptor antibodies, and which results in myasthenia gravis. Approximately 10 to 15% of the patients with myasthenia gravis will have associated thymoma, whereas 30% or more of patients with thymoma will have myasthenia gravis. What are the treatment options? Long-acting cholinesterase drugs, immunosuppressives like systemic steroids, azathioprine, cyclosporine, methotrexate, and cyclophosphamide, surgical thymectomy, plasmapheresis, and intravenous immunoglobulin. The basic principles of thymic surgery, especially for myasthenia, is mediastinal exploration, on-block resection of the thymus gland, including the cervical folds and adjacent mediastinal tract, protection of the phrenic nerves, and prevention of intrapleural dissemination. If the myasthenic patient cannot be stabilized with medication, preoperative plasmapheresis is required prior to thymectomy. Preoperative anesthetic medication is minimal, usually consisting of only atropine and mild sedative. Preoperative anticholinergic medications are avoided. Muscle relaxants should be avoided. Deep anesthesia is maintained by an inhalation agent and short-acting rapamycin. Controversies in thymectomy, again, there are controversies about median sternotomy versus VADS versus robotics. In the minimal invasive techniques, the approach would be right-sided only, left-sided only, bilateral, or the present a newer technique of subdeployed thymectomy. We come to chest wall lesions. Chest wall lesions are usually tumors, primary tumors or metastatic, congenital defects, like this carinatum or the excavator, colon syndrome, and infections. Infections can cause because of radionecrosis and of course, trauma. Tumors could be benign and malignant. The commonest tumors are the chondrosarcoma, the myeloma. The principles of treatment in these patients are excisional rather than incisional biopsy should be performed if a primary chest wall tumor is suspected. Full thickness excision of the tumor with one rib margin is necessary. Do not compromise resection to avoid large chest wall defect. Needle biopsy is best for suspicious mets or myeloma only. Sternal tumor should be treated by sternotomy. Principles of reconstruction, a defect less than 5 centimeters does not require reconstruction. Posterior defects do not require reconstruction due to scapula. Defects larger than 5 centimeters will require reconstruction. Skeleton stabilization can be accomplished with a mesh patch or a methyl methacrylate, or even nowadays titanium bars and plates are available. Soft tissue reconstruction can be done in a variety of ways, including microcutaneous flaps, latissimus dorsi, pectoralis major, rectus abdominis, and omental transposition. So, if the extent of resection is less than 3 ribs or less than 5 centimeters, no reconstruction is required. If it is more than 3 ribs or 5 ribs, if it is posterior, and above the fourth rib, no reconstruction is required again. However, lateral and anterior chest wall tumors will require some amount of reconstruction, either with a mesh patch or a rigid structure. And need for soft tissue coverage, if it is less than 5 centimeters, sometimes you can get away with a primary closure. Otherwise, you will need to have a microcutaneous flap and closure. An example of a large chest wall tumor was removed with both intra and extra thoracic portion. It was a chondrosarcoma, and after this, this is the tumor, and this was the defect was reconstructed with a Foley mesh. This is a tumor arising from the sternum. External portion. Actually, it was basically from the soft tissue in front of the sternum. The bone actually was not involved. So we got away with excision of the chest wall tumor and reconstructed the huge defect with a latissimus dorsi flap. The other condition in the chest wall is a pectus excavatum. The indication for surgery in a pectus excavatum is with a Haller index 3.25 or greater. Cardiac evaluation demonstrates cardiac compression, displacement, MVP with gross MR, conduction abnormalities, etc. Pulmonary function is compromised, or a previous repair has failed, or these are the indications for surgery in a pectus excavatum. Surgery is usually not offered purely for cosmetic. This is the Haller index. This is the ratio of the transverse diameter from the anteroposterior diameter. If it is more than normal, is about 2.5. If it is more than 3.25 to as high as 5.5, then this is an indication for surgical intervention. The two techniques that are available are the Ravitch procedure, involves an incision across the chest and the removal of the cartilage, and causes it, that causes the defect. The sternum is then placed in the normal position. If necessary, sternum is placed by a osteotomy. Occasionally, external turnover may also be required. The other procedure, which is more popular now, the NURSE procedure, now preferred operation for surgical correction. It is a minimal invasive technique whereby one to three curved metal bars are inserted behind the sternum with thoracoscopic guidance, and in order to push it to a normal position, push the sternum to the normal position, the bars are left in situ for 2-3 years and then removed. Now we come to another case of a distressing symptom that you usually see in the thoracic surgical scenario. Hemoptysis. It could be infectious, vascular, atrogenic, coagulopathic, traumatic, neoplastic, and pulmonary miscellaneous. The most common cause of hemoptysis in our country is, of course, tuberculosis. And the pathophysiology, massive hemoptysis involves disruption of the bronchial or pulmonary circulation pathologically exposed to high pressure of the bronchial circulation. Bronchial arterial tree becomes hyperplastic or tortuous, increase in capillaries due to adhesion. The mechanism in tuberculosis varies with stage, type, and location of the disease. In acute exudative lesion, softening of the lung tissue, bleeding from small branch of pulmonary artery or vein. In chronic fibro-ulcerative disease, rupture of the pseudoaneurysm of an artery traversing the wall of the cavity can lead to massive hemoptysis. Erosion from a healed calcific node impinging on the bronchial wall, acute ulceration of the bronchial mucosa and endobronchial TV, and destroyed architecture of the lung as in bronchiectasis with its attendant hypervascularized, dilated and tortuous bronchial circulation can also cause massive hemoptysis. A few slides about esophagus, because most of you who are going to be appearing for FRCS will have considerable amount of esophagus questions or even a case given to you. I'm sure there are, I'm not going to go into all the details, but there are, I'm sure, I believe further lectures are being planned for esophagus. So this is the basic anatomy of the esophagus. The lengths are given here, and the various landmarks are shown here. Basically, the esophagus in the anatomical measure is divided into cervical, thoracic, and abdominal. Functionally, they are divided into the upper esophageal sphincter, the tubular portion, and the lower esophageal sphincter. Surgically, we treat the esophagus as proximal cervical, proximal thoracic, distal thoracic, and abdominal esophagus. For various conditions, we start with hiatus hernia. When there is a suspicion of a hiatus hernia, esophagography is performed. That means usually a variant follow. And if there is a sliding hernia and there are no symptoms, nothing need be done. Symptoms are positive, esophagoscopy, manometry, and pH monitoring. Initially, medical treatment is done. If there is response, then the patient is left alone. If there is no response, then they are resorted to surgical repair, either transabdominal or transthoracic, where you can do a Nissen or a Hill procedure or a Belsey procedure. Paraesophageal hernia, hiatus hernias usually are prone for complications, especially volvulus of the stomach, and so surgical repair is the treatment of choice of paraesophageal hiatus hernia. Strictures. Strictures are the most common indication for resection. Strictures may be neoplastic, largely malignant, inflammatory, corrosive, post-operative, or following instrument. Corrosive structures can present a very morbid scenario. Benign tumors and GIS are being gastrointestinal tumors being diagnosed more frequently, and they may be also be required to do resection. Corrosives can be due to alkali. Alkali corrosive structures are edematous in reaction. Diffusion to deeper layers are common. Acid, usually coagulation type of corrosion. Deeper layers are not often involved in acid corrosives. Sites usually involved is around the aortic arch, cervical region, and behind the heart. They could be localized, partial or complete, single or multiple. Or they could be extensive, which could be soft or rigid. And they are graded into four grades. Grade one, fibrosis not involving the entire circumference. Grade two is annular strictures. Grade three is dumbbell strictures, less than 1 centimeter. Grade four is a stricture more than 1 centimeter and confined to, if they are confined to superficial layers, they are dilatable. If they are dense and fibrotic, they're usually not dilatable. So what happens in a corrosive ingestion? Edema and necrosis occurs in 24 to 48 hours. Wall of the polynuclear, wall of polynuclear lymphocytes and granulate tissue occurs. Visceral thrombosis and bacterial invasion. That leads to necrotic tissue, sloughs off usually on the 7th day. Fibroblastic proliferation and collagen deposition follows. And then paraesophageal scarring and adhesion. This can either progress to a stricture formation, or if there is a weakened wall, it can lead to a perforation. Peptic strictures can also occur because basically of GE reflux causes esophagitis, shortening and scarring, which forms a vicious cycle again. Or it can form GE reflux causes non-propulsive contractions, delayed emptying, prolonged sphincter relaxation, and back to GE reflex. Both these things end up with a peptic stricture. Benign tumors of the esophagus are non-neoplastic tumor-like conditions. The commonest would be a leiomyoma, squamous papilloma, esophageal cyst, microvascular polyp, etc. All these may require excision. Now with various techniques, more and more minimal invasive techniques, and also per oral endoscopic excision of these submucosal tumors are being done frequently. Cancer, you have various the TNM classification slightly varies with the rest of the things. T1 is involving lamina propria, submucosa. T2 involves the muscularis mucosa. T3 is adventitia involvement, and T4 is adjacent structures. In the regional nodes, cervical, megaspinal, celiac, and gastroesophageal nodes, depending on the location of the primary in the esophagus. N0 is non-nodal mets, N1 is positive loco-regional nodal mets. And M0 and M2, non-distant mets or positive distant mets. This is the stage grouping of the esophageal cancer. This is to depict the various stages of the TNM. This is carcinoma in situ, mucosa, submucosa, involvement of the mucosa, involvement of the entire wall, adventitia, and to the surrounding structure. Most of these cancers are highly lethal. Early cancer, TI, in situ, T1, N0, N0 is very rare. 25 to 30% are in stage 4 at diagnosis. This is because the esophagus is a distensible organ. And a patient will not even realize that he has got dysphagia until almost 75% of the lumen is compromised. That is why most of these patients come very, very late, and most of the patients are subjected to palliative treatment. 65 to 70% are locally advanced, stage 2, 3. Less than 60% of these can have resection. 70% of them have regional node mets, and 5-year survival at present is only about 20%. These are the various, this is the stage grouping again depicted in the pictorially. Now, esophageal resections. Well, what are the organs or the conduits that are available to us to replace the esophage? Stomach. Stomach is the best option when healthy and usable. It has an abundant blood supply. It can be mobilized so much that it can be brought up into the neck and anastomosed into the neck, the cervical disabilities. Colon is the next choice. Left is preferable for length. This is based on the middle colic and the left colic arteries, and transverse and the right colon can also be used. Again, this can be used either isoperistaltic or antiperistaltic, depending on what the length and the suitability of the pedicle is available. Isolated jejunum or ileum are also used. Vascularity is tenuous. It is extremely delicate. Microvascular anastomosis is usually required to improve survival of the graft. Indication for colon interposition is if you have a desire to maintain gastric reservoir, especially in a benign region like a stricture, and in a young patient, then you would try to preserve the reservoir function of the stomach, and you would probably use the colon. Again, if the gastric mucosa, the prior gastric surgery is already being performed, or notoriously corrosive structures can cause pyloric stenosis as well, then the stomach will not be available for the conduit, and then colon has to be used as a roux and why. It will enable a complete resection, including the upper GI gastroesophage. So where to place the conduit? The shortest distance is in the posterior mediastinum. Esophagus should be resectable. In the early stage of cancer, where the entire esophagus can easily be dissected and taken off without much problem for any reason. This is to show the various where to place the conduit. The placement in the posterior mediastinum, where the esophagus normally rises, is the best option. The next option would be the retrosternal, and subcutaneous plane is the last option. So a patient with cancer esophagus, stage T4, transesophageal fistula, retroesophageal fistula, goes only for palliation. Stage 4B with visceral mets, only for palliation. Resectable disease, RO resection possible, then risk assessment, good risk, radical resection. If there is not a good risk, study protocol, neoadjuvant, RT or CT can be done and then reassessed and then taken up for surgery. Poor risk, definitive chemo or radiotherapy. Resectable disease, RO resection not possible, chemoradiation. If there is a good response, reassess for resection. If possible, poor response only for palliation. This is another algorithm, just like that, and another, more or less, telling you the same structure. This is an interesting article, esophageal cancer, an update in the International Journal of Surgery. So if you have a chance, this is published in 2010, and I'm sure there are more recent articles come up, although I have now stopped doing it because I don't have the actual recent data. So if you are interested, you should be able to look into these data. This is achalasia, motility disorder. So where there is motility disorder involving the mesenteric and myenteric plexus, and the esophagoscopy shows no carcinoma, manometry shows esophageal sphincter involvement, medical therapy first. If there is less than 30 laparoscopic esophagomyotomy, diverticulum of esophagalasia, you can do a laparoscopic or a tonsoscopic myotomy. If there is carcinoma, T for carcinoma is biggest guideline. If there is a sigmoid esophagus, esophagotomy, esophagectomy can be done. If a high risk patient, endoscopic Botox injection has been tried. And if there is more than 30, initial couple of times you can try pneumatic dilatation, but there are chances of complications like perforation. Empty the stomach just before surgery with a large bore gastric tube. Avoid long incision on the gastric wall. Stop at the first gastric vessels. Avoid a short proximal incision, which may result in incomplete myotomy. Up to 6 to 8 centimeters is sufficient. If you're doing it from the abdomen, this is what it is. But many of us have done it from the chest. So the myotomy should, strictly speaking, extend up to the inferior pulmonary vein and very little onto the distal portion of the stomach. Dissect the hypertrophied esophageal muscle around 50% of its circumference. Never use a complete wrap around the esophagogastric junction like a Nissen fundoplication. It reaches the purpose of releasing the lower sphincter if you go back and then do a complete 360 degrees. Place a loose 180 degree fundoplication anteriorly to keep the esophagus intra-abdominally, to keep the edges of the myotomy apart and to seal any perforation. Look for an associated hiatal hernia and repair it. Do not place a nasogastric tube. Offer a liquid diet on the day of surgery and allow the patient to be discharged within 24 to 48 hours. Avoid it. You have made sure that you have not caused a perforation, because in the esophagus, the submucosa is the strongest layer. Mucosa layer is the strongest layer, and the esophagus is devoid of serosa. So any small leaks will not flow spontaneously as in the rest of the body. The next thing is esophageal perforation. This is usually as an emergency that comes into the casualty, and many of the residents don't know what to do. And what is, first you have to say what is the etiology of the perforation, where is the perforation located, cervical, thoracic or abdominal, is it a contained perforation or a free perforation into the pleural or the peritoneal space. How extensive is the extraluminal soilage? What is the time interval since the perforation? What is the clinical condition of the patient and what are their comorbidities? Is there pre-existing esophageal pathology? Is the esophagus worth salvaging? And does the patient meet criteria for non-operative management? These are all the questions to be answered before you decide upon what to do. History physical examination, PA, lateral chest x-ray and the neck x-ray, obvious. Once you have done that, esophagography. Again, here you have to be very careful. In the olden days, people used to use the rigid scope and cause more trouble. Nowadays, we have the flexible fiber scope, but however, you should be very careful inflating the esophagus with air or gas. So if it is in the cervical region, drainage and repair. If it is in the thoracic region, you can have either non-operative or operative limbs. The non-operative will be ICD, antibiotics and nutrition. the operative section, you will have esophageal gastrectomy or a thoracotomy, drainage, closure, and repair. Suggested criteria for non-operative management of esophageal perforation: limited intraluminal dissection, contained transmural perforation with drainage back into the esophagus, no associated distal obstruction, perforation not into abdominal cavity, no evidence of sepsis, esophagus worth salvaging. Example, no malignancy or end-stage benign disease. These are the cases where you can offer a non-operative management trial if the patient, if it's successful, well and good. Otherwise, you can resort to surgery at a later instance. Factors that may mandate esophagectomy is inability to surgically repair the perforation, that is a perforated malignancy, high likelihood of repair failure, high grade distal obstruction or delayed presentation, persistent esophageal disease with high likelihood of poor functional outcome, recalcitrant esophageal stricture, end stage achalasia, etc. So we already talked about this. And lastly is the peptic stricture, which we already talked about, gastroesophageal reflux disease or the GERD. So medical management is the initial mode of treatment. If the patient does well, evaluate for pathology other than GERD. If the patient has no change in symptoms, if the symptoms improve, continue with medical management. If it initiate workup for anti-reflux surgery, esophageal or duodenoscopy. If there is any suspicion of carcinoma, appropriate management of carcinoma. If there is high-grade dysplasia, repeat biopsy. If there is low-grade, normal or esophagitis, hiatus hernia, benign stricture, you do a 24-hour pH monitoring. If it is normal, just evaluate for other pathology. If it is abnormal, then you go in and do a Nissen's or a Bell's surgery. We are almost at the end of our this thing. Mankind's fascination for speed, alcohol, and drugs predisposes him to trauma. The public feels that if they go to any emergency room, they are in the hands of God. They don't realize how true that is. No, most of the time, patients are in dire situation, and you have to be very active in managing your thoracic trauma. Pathophysiology or disturbance of function results, thoracic trauma can result with acute chest wall pain, changes in the chest wall compliance and mechanics, unstable chest wall defect, altered pleural pressures, increased work of breathing, lung parenchymal damage, retained bronchial secretions, acute cardiovascular alterations, and airway injury. So chest wall trauma can involve blunt trauma, penetrating trauma due to gunshot wounds or stab injuries, explosions. Nowadays, these are becoming a more common thing with a lot of global terrorism. Chemical events, nerve agents, blister agents, choking agents, and blood agents are all being used in warfare as well as terrorism. We also have biological agents, inhalational anthrax, plague, tularemia, viral hemorrhagic fever, rifampicin. And to be effective, these, and of course, nowadays we have having COVID, which predominantly causes pneumonia and ARDS. Most of these biological agents result in pneumonia, ARDS, parenchymal hemorrhage, necrotizing mediastinitis, etc. So when we consider trauma, I was listening to Dr. Samir Bhatia's lecture and the interactive session, and I found quite a few of the students fumbling around and really struggling to come up with proper logical answers. So you have to think systematically and find out what are all the involved structures that are involved in trauma. So the chest wall, soft tissue, ribs, pleura, sternum, and thoracic spine, internal structures of the lung, heart, major vessels, esophagus, and diaphragm. So diaphragm rupture can also occur with pelvic bone fracture, with acute increase in intra-abdominal pressure, lower rib fractures, or a springing injury with injury to the liver and spleen, abdominal vessel injuries can also cause diaphragmatic rupture. Fracture of the sternum can result in thoracic aortic rupture, the classical deceleration injury at the aortic isthmus, myocardial contusion, thoracic spine fracture at the level of T4, T5. And clay chest is very common in a severe trauma, especially cases like fall from a height, a heavy object falling on the chest, or a steering wheel injury. There are multiple rib fractures, pneumothorax and pneumothoraces, and lung contusions and lacerations can occur. So what are the priorities in thoracic trauma? You have to establish a patent airway, restore circulation and oxygen transport, occlude sucking chest wound, drain the pleural space, re-expand the lungs, stop bleeding, stabilize the chest wall, and then evaluate ventilation with and arterial bypass. The seven immediately life-threatening chest injuries are proximal airway obstruction, open pneumothorax, plain chest, massive pneumothorax, tension pneumothorax, cardiac tamponade, or air embolism. These are immediate life-threatening situations which need to be addressed either at the site of injury or as soon as the patient arrives in the casualty. Six relatively life-threatening chest injuries are tracheobronchial rupture, pulmonary contusion, diaphragmatic rupture, major vascular injury, esophageal perforation, and myocardial contusion. Look for air where it shouldn't be. Pneumothorax, pneumomediastinum, subcutaneous emphysema, systemic venous air embolism, pneumopericardium, pneumoperitoneum, or retroperitoneum. The indications of severity in chest trauma, there are multiple rib fractures, sternum fracture, first rib fracture, diaphragm rupture, plain chest injury, open pneumothorax, massive pneumothorax, and a laryngeal fracture. No two trauma cases are the same. Every type and combination of injuries cannot be written in a book. Surgeons need to act fast and think on their feet. If a patient with major trauma reaches the hospital, that means natural selection has already taken place and he deserves all measures to save his life. Thank you for a patient hearing, and I suppose many of you will be in this frame of mind.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Sri Krishna. It's been an amazing lecture. We've been a superb summary of almost everything in thoracic surgery that a student can see in the exam. So I think this is a very important recording which we will keep on our website so that people can then go back to it and listen to it again and again and make down notes from each one of your slides, because there were some very important points that you put across. On almost every topic.
I combined everything in it so that it could become a ready reckoner in the last minute preparation.
Yeah, absolutely.
Any questions?
Okay. Sorry, sir, I got disconnected in the process. So I'm back. Let me just make sure that we are still recording. Okay. All right. So anybody's got any questions, guys, that you want to ask? I have a few which I wanted to ask you on behalf of the students. This is not related to the topic that you covered, but related to the exams per se, because you've been an examiner for such a long time. So I wanted to ask you your views on these situations. Why do people fail the exams?
Well, as I told you right in the beginning, most of the time, you see, no examiner will come to an exam with an intention of failing the candidate.
Dr. Srikrishna, could you just switch, stop sharing so we can then see your whole... I'm going to stop it on my end.
Sorry?
Can you stop sharing the screen so that
okay.
we can see your full video on our screen?
Okay. Right?
Okay, just 1 second. Yeah, that's better. That's perfect. Okay, so tell us, why do candidates fail in the exam? Hello?